Why Google made the NSAINSURG Intelligence, a new crowd-funded investigative journalism project, breaks the exclusive story of how the United States intelligence community funded, nurtured and incubated Google, as part of a drive to dominate the world through control of information. Seed funded by the NSA and CIA, Google was merely the first among a plethora of private sector startups co-opted by US intelligence to retain information superiority. The origins of this ingenious strategy trace back to a secret Pentagon-sponsored group that for the last two decades has functioned as a bridge between the US government and elites across the business, industry, finance, corporate, and media sectors. The group has allowed some of the most powerful special interests in corporate America to systematically circumvent democratic accountability and the rule of law, to influence government policies, as well as public opinion in the US and around the world. The results have been catastrophic: NSA mass surveillance, a permanent state of global war, and a new initiative to transform the US military into Skynet. This exclusive is being released for free in the public interest, and was enabled by crowdfunding. I'd like to thank my amazing community of patrons for their support, which gave me the opportunity to work on this in-depth investigation. Please support independent, investigative journalism for the global commons. Mass surveillance is about control. Its promulgators may well claim, and even believe, that it is about control for the greater good, a control that is needed to keep a cap on disorder, to be fully vigilant to the next threat. But in a context of rampant political corruption, widening economic inequalities, and escalating resource stress due to climate change and energy volatility, mass surveillance can become a tool of power to merely perpetuate itself, at the public's expense. A major function of mass surveillance that is often overlooked is that of knowing the adversary to such an extent that they can be manipulated into defeat. The problem is that the adversary is not just terrorists. It's you and me. To this day, the role of information warfare as propaganda has been in full swing, though systematically ignored by much of the media. Here, INSURGE Intelligence exposes how the Pentagon Highlands Forum's co-optation of tech giants like Google to pursue mass surveillance has played a key role in secret efforts to manipulate the media as part of an information war against the American government, the American people, and the rest of the world, to justify endless war and ceaseless military expansionism. The war machine in September 2013. The website of the Monterey Institute for International Studies? Cybersecurity Initiative MISI Seconds posted a final version of a paper on cyber deterrence by CIA consultant Jeffrey Cooper, vice president of the US defense contractor SAIC and a founding member of the Pentagon's Highlands Forum. The paper was presented to then NSA Director General Keith Alexander at a Highlands Forum session titled Cyber Commons, Engagement and Deterrence. In 2010, MISI Seconds is formally partnered with the Pentagon's Highlands Forum through an MOU signed between the Provost and Forum President Richard O'Neill, while the initiative itself is funded by George C. Lee, the Goldman Sachs executive, who led the billion-dollar valuations of Facebook, Google, eBay, and other tech companies. Cooper's eye-opening paper is no longer available at the MISI site, but a final version of it is available via the logs of a public national security conference hosted by the American Bar Association. Currently, Cooper is chief innovation officer at SAIC Leidos, which is among a consortium of defense technology firms including Booz Allen Hamilton and others contracted to develop NSA surveillance capabilities. The Highlands Forum briefing for the NSA chief was commissioned under contract by the Undersecretary of Defense for Intelligence, and based on concepts developed at previous forum meetings. It was presented to General Alexander at a closed session of the Highlands Forum moderated by MISI's EC Director, Dr. Admar Lockard, at the Center for Strategic and International Studies CSIS in Washington, D.C. Like Rumsfeld's SIO roadmap, Cooper's NSA briefing described digital information systems as both a great source of vulnerability and powerful tools and weapons? For national security? He advocated the need for a cyber intelligence to maximize in-depth knowledge of potential and actual adversaries so they can identify every potential leverage point that can be exploited for deterrence or retaliation. Network deterrence requires the U.S. intelligence community to develop deep understanding and specific knowledge about the particular networks involved and their patterns of linkages, including types and strengths of bonds, as well as using cognitive and behavioral science to help predict patterns. His paper went on to essentially set out a theoretical architecture for modeling data obtained from surveillance and social media mining on potential adversaries and counterparties. A year after this briefing with the NSA chief, Michelle Westlander Quaid, another Highlands Forum delegate, joined Google to become chief technology officer, leaving her senior role in the Pentagon advising the Undersecretary of Defense for Intelligence. 2 months earlier, the Defense Science Board DSB Task Force on Defense Intelligence published its report on counterinsurgency COIN, intelligence, surveillance and reconnaissance IRS operations. Quaid was among the government intelligence experts who advised and briefed the Defense Science Board Task Force in preparing the report. Another expert who briefed the task force was Highlands Forum veteran Lynn Wells. The DSB report itself had been commissioned by Bush appointee James Clapper, then Undersecretary of Defense for Intelligence, who had also commissioned Quaid's Highlands Forum briefing to General Alexander. Clapper's now Obama's Director of National Intelligence, in which capacity he lied under oath to Congress, by claiming in March 2013 that the NSA does not collect any data at all on American citizens. Michelle Quaid's track record across the U.S. military intelligence community was to transition agencies into using web tools and cloud technology. The imprint of her ideas are evident in key parts of the DSB Task Force report, which described its purpose as being to influence investment decisions at the Pentagon by recommending appropriate intelligence capabilities to assess insurgencies, understand a population and their environment, and support COIN operations. The report named 24 countries in South and Southeast Asia, North and West Africa, the Middle East and South America, which would pose possible COIN challenges for the U.S. military in coming years. These included Pakistan, Mexico, Yemen, Nigeria, Guatemala, Gaza, West Bank, Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Lebanon, among other autocratic regimes. The report argued that economic crises, climate change, demographic pressures, resource scarcity, or poor governance could cause these states or others to fail or become so weak that they become targets for aggressors' insurgents. From there, the global information infrastructure and social media can rapidly amplify the speed, intensity, and momentum of events with regional implications. Such areas could become sanctuaries from which to launch attacks on the U.S. homeland, recruit personnel, and finance, train, and supply operations. The imperative in this context is to increase the military's capacity for left-of-bank operations before the need for a major armed forces commitment to avoid insurgencies or preempt them while still in incipient phase. The report goes on to conclude that the Internet and social media are critical sources of social network analysis data in societies that are not only literate, but also connected to the Internet. This requires monitoring the blogosphere and other social media across many different cultures and languages to prepare for population-centric operations. The Pentagon must also increase its capacity for behavioral modeling and simulation to better understand and anticipate the actions of a population based on foundation data on populations, human networks, geography, and other economic and social characteristics. Such population-centric operations will also increasingly be needed in nascent resource conflicts, whether based on water crises, agricultural stress, environmental stress, or rents from mineral resources. This must include monitoring population demographics as an organic part of the natural resource framework. Other areas for augmentation are overhead video surveillance, high-resolution terrain data, cloud computing capability, data fusion. For all forms of intelligence in a consistent spatiotemporal framework, for organizing and indexing the data. Developing social science frameworks that can support spatiotemporal encoding and analysis, distributing multi-form biometric authentication technologies such as fingerprints, retina scans and DNA samples. To the point of service of the most basic administrative processes. In order to tie identity to all an individual's transactions. In addition, the Academy must be brought in to help the Pentagon develop anthropological, sociocultural, historical, human geographical, educational, public health, and many other types of social and behavioral science data and information. To develop a deep understanding of populations. A few months after joining Google, Quaid represented the company in August 2011 at the Pentagon's Defense Information Systems Agency DISA Customer and Industry Forum. The forum would provide the services, combatant commands, agencies, coalition forces, the opportunity to directly engage with industry on innovative technologies, to enable and ensure capabilities in support of our warfighters. Participants in the event have been integral to efforts to create a defense enterprise information environment, defined as an integrated platform which includes the network, computing, environment, services, information assurance, and NetOps capabilities, enabling warfighters to connect, identify themselves, discover and share information, and collaborate across the full spectrum of military operations. Most of the forum panelists were DoD officials, except for just four industry panelists including Google's Quaid. DISA officials have attended the Highlands Forum, too, such as Paul Friedrichs, a technical director and chief engineer of DISA's Office of the Chief Information Assurance Executive. Knowledge is power. Given all this, it is hardly surprising that in 2012, a few months after Highlands Forum co-chair Regina Duggan left DARPA to join Google as a senior executive, then NSA Chief General Keith Alexander was emailing Google's founding executive Sergey Brin to discuss information sharing for national security. In those emails, obtained under freedom of information by investigative journalist Jason Leopold, General Alexander described Google as a key member of the U.S. military's defense industrial base, a position Michelle Quaid was apparently consolidating. Brin's jovial relationship with the former NSA chief now makes perfect sense, given that Brin had been in contact with representatives of the CIA and NSA, who partly funded and oversaw his creation of the Google search engine, since the mid-1990s. In July of 2014, Quaid spoke at U.S. Army panel on the creation of a rapid acquisition cell to advance the U.S. Army's cyber capabilities. As part of the Force 2025 Transformation Initiative, she told Pentagon officials that many of the Army's 2025 technology goals can be realized with commercial technology available or in development today, reaffirming that industry is ready to partner with the Army in supporting the new paradigm. Around the same time, most of the media was trumpeting the idea that Google was trying to distance itself from Pentagon funding. But in reality, Google has switched tactics to independently develop commercial technologies, which would have military applications, the Pentagon's transformation goals. Yet Quaid is hardly the only point person in Google's relationship with the U.S. military intelligence community. 1 year after Google bought the satellite mapping software Keyhole from CIA venture capital firm InQtel in 2004, InQtel's Director of Technical Assessment Rob Painter, who played a key role in InQtel's Keyhole investment in the first place, moved to Google. At InQtel, Painter's work focused on identifying, researching and evaluating new startup technology firms that were believed to offer tremendous value to the CIA, the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency, and the Defense Intelligence Agency. Indeed, the NGA had confirmed that its intelligence obtained via Keyhole was used by the NSA, to support US operations in Iraq from 2003 onwards. A former US Army Special Operations Intelligence officer, Painter's new job at Google, as of July 2005, was federal manager of what Keyhole was to become, Google Earth Enterprise. By 2007, Painter had become Google's federal chief technologist. That year, Painter told the Washington Post that Google was in the beginning stages of selling advanced secret versions of its products to the US government. Google has ramped up its sales force in the Washington area in the past year to adapt its technology products to the needs of the military, civilian agencies and the intelligence community, the Post reported. The Pentagon was already using a version of Google Earth developed in partnership with Lockheed Martin to display information for the military on the ground in Iraq, including mapping out displays of key regions of the country and outlining Sunni and Shiite neighborhoods in Baghdad, as well as US and Iraqi military bases in the city. Neither Lockheed nor Google would say how the geospatial agency uses the data. Google aimed to sell the government new enhanced versions of Google Earth and search engines that can be used internally by agencies. White House records leaked in 2010 showed that Google executives had held several meetings with senior US National Security Council officials. Alan Davidson, Google's government affairs director, had at least three meetings with officials of the National Security Council in 2009, including White House Senior Director for Russian Affairs Mike McFaul and Middle East Advisor Daniel Shapiro. It also emerged from a Google patent application that the company had deliberately been collecting payload data from private Wi-Fi networks that would enable the identification of geolocations. In the same year, we now know, Google had signed an agreement with the NSA giving the agency open-ended access to the personal information of its users and its hardware and software, in the name of cybersecurity agreements that General Alexander was busy replicating with hundreds of telecom CEOs around the country. Thus, it is not just Google that is a key contributor and foundation of the US military-industrial complex, it is the entire Internet and the wide range of private sector companies, many nurtured and funded under the mantle of the US intelligence community or powerful financiers embedded in that community, which sustain the Internet and the telecoms infrastructure. It is also the myriad of startups selling cutting-edge technologies to the CIA's venture firm in Qtel, where they can then be adapted and advanced for applications across the military intelligence community. Ultimately, the global surveillance apparatus and the classified tools used by agencies like the NSA to administer it have been almost entirely made by external researchers and private contractors like Google, which operate outside the Pentagon. This structure, mirrored in the workings of the Pentagon's Highlands Forum, allows the Pentagon to rapidly capitalize on technological innovations it would otherwise miss, while also keeping the private sector at arm's length, at least ostensibly, to avoid uncomfortable questions about what such technology is actually being used for. But isn't it obvious, really? The Pentagon is about war, whether overt or covert. By helping build the technological surveillance infrastructure of the NSA, firms like Google are complicit in what the military-industrial complex does best, kill for cash. As the nature of mass surveillance suggests, its target is not merely terrorists, but by extension, terrorism suspects and potential terrorists. The upshot being that entire populations, especially political activists, must be targeted by US intelligence surveillance to identify active and future threats, and to be vigilant against hypothetical populist insurgencies both at home and abroad. Predictive analytics and behavioral profiles play a pivotal role here. Mass surveillance and data mining also now has a distinctive operational purpose in assisting with the lethal execution of special operations, selecting targets for the CIA's drone strike lists via dubious algorithms, for instance, along with providing geospatial and other information for combatant commanders on land, air and sea, among many other functions. A single social media post on Twitter or Facebook is enough, to trigger being placed on secret terrorism watch lists solely due to a vaguely defined hunch or suspicion, and can potentially even land a suspect on a kill list. The push for indiscriminate, comprehensive mass surveillance by the military-industrial complex encompassing the Pentagon, intelligence agencies, defense contractors, and supposedly friendly tech giants like Google and Facebook is therefore not an end in itself, but an instrument of power, whose goal is self-perpetuation. But there is also a self-rationalizing justification for this goal. While being great for the military-industrial complex, it is also, supposedly, great for everyone else. The Long War? No better illustration of the truly chauvinistic, narcissistic, and self-congratulatory ideology of power at the heart of the military-industrial complex is a book by longtime Highlands Forum delegate, Dr. Thomas Barnett, The Pentagon's New Map. Barnett was assistant for strategic futures in the Pentagon's Office of Force Transformation from 2001 to 2003, and had been recommended to Richard O'Neill by his boss Vice Admiral Arthur Sprowsky. Apart from becoming a New York Times bestseller, Barnett's book had been read far and wide in the US military, by senior defense officials in Washington and combatant commanders operating on the ground in the Middle East. Barnett first attended the Pentagon Highlands Forum in 1998, then was invited to deliver a briefing about his work at the forum on December 7, 2004, which was attended by senior Pentagon officials, energy experts, internet entrepreneurs, and journalists. Barnett received a glowing review in the Washington Post from his Highlands Forum buddy David Ignatius a week later, and an endorsement from another forum friend, Thomas Friedman, both of which helped massively boost his credibility and readership. Barnett's vision is neoconservative to the root. He sees the world as divided into essentially two realms, the core, which consists of advanced countries playing by the rules of economic globalization, the US, Canada, UK, Europe and Japan, along with developing countries committed to getting there, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and some others, and the rest of the world, which is the gap, a disparate wilderness of dangerous and lawless countries defined fundamentally by being disconnected from the wonders of globalization. This includes most of the Middle East and Africa, large swathes of South America, as well as much of Central Asia and Eastern Europe. It is the task of the United States to shrink the gap by spreading the cultural and economic rule set of globalization that characterizes the core, and by enforcing security worldwide to enable that rule set to spread. These two functions of US power are captured by Barnett's concepts of Leviathan and System Administrator. The former is about rule setting to facilitate the spread of capitalist markets, regulated via a military and civilian law. The latter is about projecting military force into the gap in an open-ended global mission to enforce security and engage in nation-building, not rebuilding. He is keen to emphasize, but building new nations? For Barnett, the Bush administration's 2002 introduction of the Patriot Act at home, with its crushing of habeas corpus, and the national security strategy abroad, with its opening up of unilateral, preemptive war, represented the beginning of the necessary rewriting of rule sets in the core to embark on this noble mission. This is the only way for the US to achieve security, writes Barnett, because as long as the gap exists, it will always be a source of lawless violence and disorder. One paragraph in particular sums up his vision. America as global cop creates security. Security creates common rules. Rules attract foreign investment. Investment creates infrastructure. Infrastructure creates access to natural resources. Resources create economic growth. Growth creates stability. Stability creates markets. And once you re a growing, stable part of the global market, you re part of the core. Mission accomplished? Much of what Barnett predicted would need to happen to fulfill this vision, despite its neoconservative bent, is still being pursued under Obama. In the near future, Barnett had predicted, US military forces will be dispatched beyond Iraq and Afghanistan to places like Uzbekistan, Djibouti, Azerbaijan, Northwest Africa, Southern Africa and South America. Barnett's Pentagon briefing was greeted with near-universal enthusiasm. The forum had even purchased copies of his book, and had them distributed to all forum delegates, and in May 2005, Barnett was invited back to participate in an entire forum themed around his sysadmin concept. The Highlands Forum has thus played a leading role in defining the Pentagon's entire conceptualization of the war on terror. Irving Ladosky Berger, a retired IMB vice president who co-chaired the president's Information Technology Advisory Committee from 1997 to 2001, described his experience of one 2007 forum meeting in telling terms. Then there is the war on terror, which Doody has started to refer to as the long war, a term that I first heard at the forum. It seems very appropriate to describe the overall conflict in which we now find ourselves. This is a truly global conflict. The conflicts we are now in have much more of the feel of a battle of civilizations or cultures trying to destroy our very way of life and impose their own. The problem is that outside this powerful Pentagon-hosted clique, not everyone else agrees. I am not convinced that Barnett's cure would be any better than the disease, wrote Dr. Karen Kwiatkowski, a former senior Pentagon analyst in the Near East and South Asia section, who blew the whistle on how her department deliberately manufactured false information in the run-up to the Iraq War. It would surely cost far more in American liberty, constitutional democracy and blood than it would be worth. Yet the equation of shrinking the gap with sustaining the national security of the core leads to a slippery slope. It means that if the US is prevented from playing this leadership role as global cop, the gap will widen, the core will shrink, and the entire global order could unravel. By this logic, the US simply cannot afford government or public opinion to reject the legitimacy of its mission. If it did so, it would allow the gap to grow out of control, undermining the core, and potentially destroying it, along with the core's protector, America. Therefore, shrinking the gap is not just a security imperative, it is such an existential priority that it must be backed up with information war to demonstrate to the world the legitimacy of the entire project. Based on O'Neill's principles of information warfare as articulated in his 1989 US Navy brief, the targets of information war are not just populations in the gap, but domestic populations in the core, and their governments, including the US government. That secret brief, which according to former senior US intelligence official John Alexander was read by the Pentagon's top leadership, argued that information war must be targeted at adversaries to convince them of their vulnerability, potential partners around the world so they accept the cause as just, and finally, civilian populations and the political leadership so they believe that the cost in blood and treasure is worth it. Barnett's work was plugged by the Pentagon's Highlands Forum because it fit the bill in providing a compelling feel-good ideology for the US military-industrial complex. But neoconservative ideology, of course, hardly originated with Barnett, himself a relatively small player, even though his work was extremely influential throughout the Pentagon. The regressive thinking of senior officials involved in the Highlands Forum is visible from long before 9/11, which was seized upon by actors linked to the forum as a powerful enabling force that legitimized the increasingly aggressive direction of US foreign and intelligence policies. Yoda and the Soviets. The ideology represented by the Highlands Forum can be gleaned from long before its establishment in 1994, at a time when Andrew Yoda Marshall S. Anal was the primary locus of Pentagon activity on future planning. A widely held myth promulgated by national security journalists over the years is that the Anal's reputation as the Pentagon's resident oracle machine was down to the uncanny analytical foresight of its director Marshall. Supposedly, he was among the few who made the prescient recognition that the Soviet threat had been overblown by the US intelligence community. He had, the story goes, been a lone, but relentless voice inside the Pentagon, calling on policymakers to re-evaluate their projections of the USSR's military might. Except the story is not true. The annal was not about sober threat analysis, but about paranoid threat projection justifying military expansionism. Foreign policy's Jeffrey Lewis points out that far from offering a voice of reason calling for a more balanced assessment of Soviet military capabilities, Marshall tried to downplay annal findings that rejected the hype around an imminent Soviet threat. Having commissioned a study concluding that the US had overestimated Soviet aggressiveness, Marshall circulated it with a cover note declaring himself unpersuaded by its findings. Lewis charts how Marshall's threat projection mindset extended to commissioning absurd research supporting staple Neocon narratives about the non-existent Saddam al-Qaeda link, and even the notorious report by a RAND consultant calling for redrawing the map of the Middle East, presented to the Pentagon's Defense Policy Board on the invitation of Richard Perle in 2002. Investigative journalist Jason Vest similarly found from Pentagon sources that during the Cold War, Marshall had long hyped the Soviet threat and played a key role in giving the neoconservative pressure group, the Committee on the Present Danger, access to classified CIA intelligence data to rewrite the national intelligence estimate on Soviet military intentions. This was a precursor to the manipulation of intelligence after 9/11 to justify the invasion and occupation of Iraq. Former annal staffers confirmed that Marshall had been belligerent about an imminent Soviet threat until the very end. Ex-CS Sovietologist Melvin Goodman, for instance, recalled that Marshall was also instrumental in pushing for the Afghan Mujahideen to be provided with Stinger missiles, a move which made the war even more brutal, encouraging the Russians to use scorched earth tactics. Enron, the Taliban and Iraq. The post-Cold War period saw the Pentagon's creation of the Highlands Forum in 1994 under the wing of former Defense Secretary William Perry, a former CIA director and early advocate of Neocon ideas like preventive war. Surprisingly, the Forum's dubious role as a government industry bridge can be clearly discerned in relation to Enron's flirtations with the US government. Just as the Forum had crafted the Pentagon's intensifying policies on mass surveillance, it simultaneously fed directly into the strategic thinking that culminating in the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq. On November 7, 2000, George W. Bush won the US presidential elections. Enron and its employees had given over $1 million to the Bush campaign in total. That included contributing $10,500 to Bush's Florida Recount Committee, and a further $300,000 for the inaugural celebrations afterwards. Enron also provided corporate jets to shuttle Republican lawyers around Florida and Washington lobbying on behalf of Bush for the December recount. Federal election documents later showed that since 1989, Enron had made a total of $5.8 million in campaign donations, 73% to Republicans and 27% to Democrats, with as many as 15 senior Bush administration officials owning stock in Enron, including Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld, Senior Advisor Karl Rove, and Army Secretary Thomas White. Yet just one day before that controversial election, Pentagon Highlands Forum founding President Richard O'Neill wrote to Enron CEO Kenneth Lay, inviting him to give a presentation at the forum on modernizing the Pentagon and the Army. The email from O'Neill to Lay was released as part of the Enron corpus, the emails obtained by the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, but has remained unknown until now. The email began: "On behalf of Assistant Secretary of Defense C3I and UDCIO Arthur Money, and invited Lay to participate in the Secretary of Defense's Highlands Forum, which O'Neill described as a cross-disciplinary group of eminent scholars, researchers, CEOs, CIOs, CTOs from industry, and leaders from the media, the arts and the professions, who have met over the past 6 years, to examine areas of emerging interest to all of us. He added that forum sessions include seniors from the White House, Defense, and other agencies of government. We limit government participation to about 25%. Here, O'Neill reveals that the Pentagon Highlands Forum was, fundamentally, about exploring not just the goals of government, but the interests of participating industry leaders like Enron. The Pentagon, O'Neill went on, wanted Lay to feed into the search for information transformation strategies for the Department of Defense and government in general. Particularly from a business perspective, transformation, productivity, competitive advantage. He offered high praise of Enron as a remarkable example of transformation in a highly rigid, regulated industry that has created a new model and new markets. O'Neill made clear that the Pentagon wanted Enron to play a pivotal role in the DDS future, not just in the creation of an operational strategy which has information superiority, but also in relation to the DDS enormous global business enterprise, which can benefit from many of the best practices and ideas from industry. Enron is of great interest to us, he reaffirmed. What we learn from you may help the Department of Defense a great deal, as it works to build a new strategy. I hope that you have time on your busy schedule to join us for as much of the Highlands Forum as you can attend and speak with the group. That Highlands Forum meeting was attended by senior White House and U.S. intelligence officials, including CIA Deputy Director Joan A. Dempsey, who had previously served as Assistant Defense Secretary for Intelligence, and in 2003 was appointed by Bush as Executive Director of the President's Foreign Intelligence Advisory Board, in which capacity she praised extensive information sharing by the NSA and NGA after 9/11. She went on to become executive vice president at Booz Allen Hamilton, a major Pentagon contractor in Iraq and Afghanistan that, among other things, created the Coalition Provisional Authority's database to track what we now know were highly corrupt reconstruction projects in Iraq. Enron's relationship with the Pentagon had already been in full swing the previous year. Thomas White, then vice chair of Enron Energy Services, had used his extensive U.S. military connections to secure a prototype deal at Fort Hamilton to privatize the power supply of Army bases. Enron was the only bidder for the deal. The following year, after Enron's CEO was invited to the Highlands Forum, White gave his first speech in June just 2 weeks after he became Secretary of the Army, where he vowed to speed up the awarding of such contracts, along with further rapid privatization of the Army's energy services. Potentially, Enron could benefit from the speed-up in awarding contracts, as could others seeking the business, observed USA Today. That month, on the authority of Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld, who himself held significant shares in Enron, Bush's Pentagon invited another Enron executive and one of Enron's senior external financial advisors to attend a further secret Highlands Forum session. An email from Richard O'Neill dated June 22, obtained via the Enron corpus, showed that Stephen Keen, then executive vice president and chief of staff of Enron, was due to give another Highlands presentation on Monday 25. We are approaching the Secretary of Defense-sponsored Highlands Forum and very much looking forward to your participation, wrote O'Neill, promising Keen that he would be the centerpiece of discussion. Enron's experience is quite important to us, as we seriously consider transformative change in the Department of Defense. Stephen Keen is now president and co-and incoming CEO of Kinder Morgan, one of the largest energy companies in North America, and a major supporter of the controversial Keystone XL pipeline project. Due to attend the same Highlands Forum session with Keen was Richard Foster, then a senior partner at the financial consultancy McKinsey. I have given copies of Dick Foster's new book, Creative Destruction, to the Deputy Secretary of Defense as well as the Assistant Secretary, said O'Neill in his email, and the Enron case that he outlines makes for important discussion. We intend to hand out copies to the participants at the forum. Foster's firm, McKinsey, had provided strategic financial advice to Enron since the mid-1980s. Joe Skilling, who in February 2001 became Enron's CEO, while Kenneth Lay moved to chair, had been head of McKinsey's energy consulting business before joining Enron in 1990. McKinsey and then-partner Richard Foster were intimately involved in crafting the core Enron financial management strategies responsible for the company's rapid, but fraudulent, growth. While McKinsey has always denied being aware of the dodgy accounting that led to Enron's demise, internal company documents showed that Foster had attended an Enron Finance Committee meeting a month before the Highlands Forum session to discuss the need for outside private partnerships to help drive the company's explosive growth, the very investment partnerships responsible for the collapse of Enron. McKinsey documents showed that the firm was fully aware of Enron's extensive use of off-balance sheet funds. As the Independent's economics editor Ben Chu remarks, McKinsey fully endorsed the dubious accounting methods, which led to the inflation of Enron's market valuation, and that caused the company to implode in 2001. Indeed, Foster himself had personally attended six Enron board meetings from October 2000 to October 2000. That period roughly coincided with Enron's growing influence on the Bush administration's energy policies and the Pentagon's planning for Afghanistan and Iraq. But Foster was also a regular attendee at the Pentagon Highlands Forum. His LinkedIn profile describes him as member of the forum since 2000, the year he ramped up engagement with Enron. He also delivered a presentation at the inaugural Island Forum in Singapore in 2002. Enron's involvement in the Cheney Energy Task Force appears to have been linked to the Bush administration's 2001 planning for both the invasions of Afghanistan and Iraq, motivated by control of oil. As noted by Prof. Richard Falk, a former board member of Human Rights Watch and Exxon investigator, Enron's Kenneth Lay was the main confidential consultant relied upon by Vice President Dick Cheney during the highly secretive process of drafting a report outlining a national energy policy, widely regarded as a key element in the U.S. approach to foreign policy generally and the Arab world in particular. The intimate secret meetings between senior Enron executives and high-level U.S. government officials via the Pentagon Highlands Forum, from November 2000 to June 2001, played a central role in establishing and cementing the increasingly symbiotic link between Enron and Pentagon planning. The forum's role was, as O'Neill has always said, to function as an ideas lab to explore the mutual interests of industry and government. Enron and Pentagon were planning in February 2001. When Enron executives including Kenneth Lay began participating concertedly in the Cheney Energy Task Force, a classified National Security Council document instructed NSC staffers to work with the task force in melding previously separate issues, operational policies towards rogue states, and actions regarding the capture of new and existing oil and gas fields. According to Bush's Treasury Secretary Paul O'Neill, as quoted by Ron Suskind in The Price of Loyalty 2004, cabinet officials discussed an invasion of Iraq in their first NSC meeting, and had even prepared a map for a post-war occupation marking the carve-up of Iraq's oil fields. The message at that time from President Bush was that officials must find a way to do this. Cheney Energy Task Force documents obtained by Judicial Watch under Freedom of Information revealed that by March, with extensive industry input, the task force had prepared maps of Gulf State and especially Iraqi oil fields, pipelines, and refineries, along with a list titled Foreign Suitors for Iraqi Oil Field Contracts. By April, a think tank report commissioned by Cheney, overseen by former Secretary of State James Baker, and put together by a committee of energy industry and national security experts, urged the U.S. government to conduct an immediate policy review toward Iraq, including military, energy, economic and political diplomatic assessments, to deal with Iraq's destabilizing influence on oil flows to global markets. The report included recommendations from Highlands Forum delegate and Enron chair, Kenneth Lay. But Cheney's Energy Task Force was also busily pushing forward plans for Afghanistan involving Enron that had been in motion under Clinton, Through the late 1990s, Enron was working with California-based U.S. energy company Unocal to develop an oil and gas pipeline that would tap Caspian Basin reserves and carry oil and gas across Afghanistan, supplying Pakistan, India, and potentially other markets. The endeavor had the official blessing of the Clinton administration, and later the Bush administration, which held several meetings with Taliban representatives to negotiate terms for the pipeline deal throughout 2001. The Taliban, whose conquest of Afghanistan had received covert assistance under Clinton, was to receive formal recognition as the legitimate government of Afghanistan in return for permitting the installation of the pipeline. Enron paid $400 million for a feasibility study for the pipeline, a large portion of which was siphoned off as bribes to Taliban leaders, and even hired CIA agents to help facilitate. Then in summer 2001, while Enron officials were liaising with senior Pentagon officials at the Highlands Forum, the White House's National Security Council was running a cross-departmental working group led by Rumsfeld and Cheney to help complete an ongoing Enron project in India, a $3 billion power plant in Dabhol. The plant was slated to receive its energy from the Trans-Afghan Pipeline. The NSCS Dabhol Working Group, chaired by Bush's National Security Advisor Condoleezza Rice, generated a range of tactics to enhance U.S. government pressure on India to complete the Dabhol plant pressure that continued all the way to early November. The Dabhol project and the Trans-Afghan Pipeline was by far Enron's most lucrative overseas deal. Throughout 2001, Enron officials, including Ken Lay, participated in Cheney's Energy Task Force, along with representatives across the U.S. energy industry. Starting from February, shortly after the Bush administration took office, Enron was involved in about half a dozen of these Energy Task Force meetings. After one of these secret meetings, a draft energy proposal was amended to include a new provision proposing to dramatically boost oil and natural gas production in India in a way that would apply only to Enron's Dabhol power plant. In other words, ensuring the flow of cheap gas to India via the Trans-Afghan pipeline was now a matter of US national security. A month or two after this, the Bush administration gave the Taliban $43 million, justified by its crackdown on opium production, despite US imposed and sanctions preventing aid to the group for not handing over Osama bin Laden. Then in June 2001, the same month that Enron's Executive Vice President Steve Keen attended the Pentagon Highlands Forum, the company's hopes for the Dabhol project were dashed when the Trans-Afghan Pipeline failed to materialize, and as a consequence, construction on the Dabhol power plant was shut down. The failure of the $3 billion project contributed to Enron's bankruptcy in December. That month, Enron officials met with Bush's Commerce Secretary, Donald Evans, about the plant, and Cheney lobbied India's main opposition party about the Dabhol project. Ken Lay had also reportedly contacted the Bush administration around this time to inform officials about the firm's financial troubles. By August, desperate to pull off the deal, US officials threatened Taliban representatives with war if they refused to accept American terms, namely, to cease fighting and join in a federal alliance with the opposition Northern Alliance, and to give up demands for local consumption of the gas. On the 15th of that month, Enron lobbyist Pat Shortridge told then White House economic advisor Robert McNally that Enron was heading for a financial meltdown that could cripple the country's energy markets. The Bush administration must have anticipated the Taliban's rejection of the deal, because they had planned a war on Afghanistan from as early as July. According to then-Pakistani Foreign Minister Nias Naik, who had participated in the US-Taliban negotiations, US officials told him they planned to invade Afghanistan in mid-October 2001. No sooner had the war commenced, Bush's ambassador to Pakistan, Wendy Chamberlain, called Pakistan's oil minister Usman Aminuddin to discuss the proposed Turkmenistan-Afghanistan-Pakistan gas pipeline project. According to the Frontier Post, a Pakistani English-language broadsheet, They reportedly agreed that the project opens up new avenues of multidimensional regional cooperation, particularly in view of the recent geopolitical developments in the region. 2 days before 9/11, Condoleezza Rice received the draft of a formal national security presidential directive that Bush was expected to sign immediately. The directive contained a comprehensive plan to launch a global war on Al-Qaeda, including an imminent invasion of Afghanistan to topple the Taliban. The directive was approved by the highest levels of the White House and officials of the National Security Council, including, of course, Rice and Rumsfeld. The same NSC officials were simultaneously running the double working group to secure the Indian power plant deal for Enron's Trans-Afghan Pipeline project. The next day, 1 day before 9/11, the Bush administration formally agreed on the plan to attack the Taliban. The Pentagon Highlands Forum's background link with the interests involved in all this show they were not unique to the Bush administration, which is why, as Obama was preparing to pull troops out of Afghanistan, he reaffirmed his government's support for the Trans-Afghan Pipeline project and his desire for US firm to construct it. The Pentagon's propaganda fixer throughout this period, information war, played a central role in drumming up public support for war, and the Highlands Forum led the way. In December 2000, just under a year before 9/11 and shortly after George W. Bush's election victory, key forum members participated in an event at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace to explore the impact of the information revolution, globalization, and the end of the Cold War on the US foreign policy-making process. Rather than proposing incremental reforms, the meeting was for participants to build from scratch a new model that is optimized to the specific properties of the new global environment. Among the issues flagged up in the meeting was the global control revolution, the distributed nature of the information revolution was altering key dynamics of world politics by challenging the primacy of states and interstate relations. This was creating new challenges to national security, reducing the ability of leading states to control global policy debates, challenging the efficacy of national economic policies, etc. In other words, how can the Pentagon find a way to exploit the information revolution to control global policy debates, particularly on national economic policies? The meeting was co-hosted by Jamie Metzl, who at the time served on Bill Clinton's National Security Council, where he had just led the drafting of Clinton's Presidential Decision Directive 68 on International Public Information (IPI), a new multi-agency plan to coordinate US public information dissemination abroad. Metz went on to coordinate IPI at the State Department. The preceding year, a senior Clinton official revealed to the Washington Times that Metz's IPI was really aimed at spinning the American public and had emerged out of concern that the US public has refused to back President Clinton's foreign policy. The IPI would plant news stories favorable to US interests via TV, press, radio and other media based abroad, in hopes it would get picked up in American media. The pretext was that news coverage is distorted at home and they need to fight it at all costs by using resources that are aimed at spinning the news. Metz ran the IPI's overseas propaganda operations for Iraq and Kosovo. Other participants of the Carnegie meeting in December 2000 included two founding members of the Highlands Forum, Richard O'Neill and SAIC's Jeff Cooper, along with Paul Wolfowitz, another Andrew Marshall acolyte, who was about to join the incoming Bush administration as Rumsfeld's deputy defense secretary. Also present was a figure who soon became particularly notorious in the propaganda around Afghanistan and Iraq War, 2003, John W. Rendon, Jr., founding president of the Rendon Group (TRG) and another longtime Pentagon Highlands Forum member. TRG is a notorious communications firm that has been US government contractor for decades. Rendon played a pivotal role in running the State Department's propaganda campaigns in Iraq and Kosovo under Clinton and Metzl. That included receiving a Pentagon grant to run a news website the Balkans Information Exchange, and US Agency for International Development USAID contract to promote privatization. Rendon's central role in helping the Bush administration hype up the non-existent threat of weapons of mass destruction WMD to justify US military invasion is now well known. As James Bamford famously exposed in his seminal Rolling Stone investigation, Rendon played an instrumental role on behalf of the Bush administration in deploying perception management to create the conditions for the removal of Hussein from power under multi-million dollar CIA and Pentagon contracts. Among Rendon's activities was the creation of Ahmad Chalabi's Iraqi National Congress Incorporated on behalf of the CIA, a group of Iraqi exiles tasked with disseminating propaganda, including much of the false intelligence about WMD. That process had begun concertedly under the administration of George H.W. Bush, then rumbled along under Clinton with little fanfare, before escalating after 9/11 under George W. Bush. Rendon thus played a large role in the manufacture of inaccurate and false news stories relating to Iraq under lucrative CIA and Pentagon contracts, and he did so in the period running up to the 2003 invasion, as an advisor to Bush's National Security Council, the same NSC, of course, that planned the invasions of Afghanistan and Iraq, achieved with input from Enron executives, who were simultaneously engaging the Pentagon Highlands Forum. But that is the tip of iceberg. Declassified documents show that the Highlands Forum was intimately involved in the covert processes by which key officials engineered the road to war on Iraq, based on information warfare. A redacted 2007 report by the DoD's Inspector General reveals that one of the contractors used extensively by the Pentagon Highlands Forum during and after the Iraq War was none other than the Rendon Group. TRG was contracted by the Pentagon to organize forum sessions, determine subjects for discussion, as well as to convene and coordinate forum meetings. The Inspector General investigation had been prompted by accusations raised in Congress about Rendon's role in manipulating information to justify the 2003 invasion and occupation of Iraq. According to the Inspector General report, the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Networks and Information Integration Chief Information Officer employed TRG to conduct forums that would appeal to a cross-disciplinary group of nationally regarded leaders. The forums were in small groups discussing information and technologies and their effects on science, organizational and business processes, international relations, economics, and national security. TRG also conducted a research program and interviews to formulate and develop topics for the Highlands Forum focus group. The Office of the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Networks and Information Integration would approve the subjects, and TRG would facilitate the meetings. TRG, the Pentagon's private propaganda arm, thus played a central role in literally running the Pentagon Highlands Forum process that brought together senior government officials with industry executives to generate DoD information warfare strategy. The Pentagon's internal investigation absolved Rendon of any wrongdoing. But this is not surprising, given the conflict of interest at stake. The Inspector General at the time was Claude M. Kickleiter, a Bush nominee who had directly overseen the administration's key military operations. In 2003, he was director of the Pentagon's Iraq Transition Team, and the following year he was appointed to the State Department as Special Advisor on Stabilization and Security Operations in Iraq and Afghanistan. The surveillance propaganda nexus even more telling. Pentagon documents obtained by Bamford for his Rolling Stone story revealed that Rendon had been given access to the NSA's top-secret surveillance data to carry out its work on behalf of the Pentagon. TRG, the DoD documents said, is authorized to research and analyze information classified up to top-secret CCTKGHCS. C means sensitive compartmented information, data classified higher than top-secret, while C designates special intelligence, that is, highly secret communications intercepted by the NSA. TK refers to talent keyhole, code names for imagery from reconnaissance aircraft and spy satellites, while G stands for gamma, encompassing communications intercepts from extremely sensitive sources, and HCS means human control system information from a very sensitive human source. In Bamford S. words, taken together, the acronyms indicate that Randon enjoys access to the most secret information from all three forms of intelligence collection, eavesdropping, imaging satellites and human spies. So the Pentagon had, 1. Contracted Randon, a propaganda firm, 2. Given Randon access to the intelligence community's most classified information including data from NSA surveillance, 3. Tasked Randon to facilitating the DDS development of information operations strategy, by running the Highlands Forum process, 4. And further, tasked Randon with overseeing the concrete execution of this strategy developed through the Highlands Forum process, in actual information operations around the world in Iraq, Afghanistan and beyond. TRG Chief Executive John Randon remains closely involved in the Pentagon Highlands Forum and ongoing DoD information operations in the Muslim world. His November 2014 biography for the Harvard Kennedy School, Emerging Leaders, course describes him as a participant in forward-thinking organizations, such as the Highlands Forum, one of the first thought leaders to harness the power of emerging technologies in support of real-time information management, and an expert on the impact of emerging information technologies on the way populations think and behave. Randon's Harvard bio also credits him with designing and executing strategic communications initiatives and information programs related to operations Odyssey Dawn Libya, Unified Protector Libya, Global War on Terrorism GWOT, Iraqi Freedom, Enduring Freedom Afghanistan, Allied Force and Joint Guardian Kosovo, Desert Shield, Desert Storm Kuwait, Desert Fox Iraq and Just Cause Panama, among others. Randon's work on perception management and information operations has also assisted a number of US military interventions elsewhere, as well as running US information operations in Argentina, Colombia, Haiti, and Zimbabwe, in fact, a total of 99 countries. As a former executive director and national political director of the Democratic Party, John Randon remains a powerful figure in Washington under the Obama administration. Pentagon records show that TRG has received over $100 million from the DoD since 2000. In 2009, the US government canceled a strategic communications contract with TRG after revelations it was being used to weed out reporters who might write negative stories about the US military in Afghanistan, and to solely promote journalists supportive of US policy. Yet in 2010, the Obama administration re-contracted Randon to supply services for military deception in Iraq. Since then, TRG has provided advice to the US Army's Training and Doctrine Command, the Special Operations Command, and is still contracted to the Office of the Secretary of Defense, the US Army's Communications Electronic Command, as well as providing communications support to the Pentagon and US embassies on counter-narcotics operations. TRG also boasts on its website that it provides irregular warfare support, including operational and planning support, that assists our government and military clients in developing new approaches to countering and eroding an adversary's power, influence and will. Much of this support has itself been fine-tuned over the last decade or more inside the Pentagon Highlands Forum. Irregular war and pseudo-terrorism. The Pentagon Highlands Forum's intimate link, via Randon, to the propaganda operations pursued under Bush and Obama in support of the long war demonstrate the integral role of mass surveillance in both irregular warfare and strategic communications. One of the major proponents of both is Prof. John Arcola of the Naval Postgraduate School, the renownedest defense analyst credited with developing the concept of net war, who today openly advocates the need for mass surveillance and big data mining to support preemptive operations to thwart terrorist plots. It so happens that Arcola is another founding member of the Pentagon's Highlands Forum. Much of his work on the idea of networked warfare, networked deterrence, information warfare, and swarming, largely produced for RAND under Pentagon contract, was incubated by the forum during its early years and thus became integral to Pentagon strategy. For instance, in Arcola S1999 RAND's study, The Emergence of New Politique, Toward an American Information Strategy, he and his co-author David Renfelt express their gratitude to Richard O'Neill for his interest, support and guidance, and to members of the Highlands Forum for their advance comments on the study. Most of his RAND work credits the Highlands Forum and O'Neill for their support. Arquilla's work was cited in a 2006 National Academy of Sciences study on the future of network science commissioned by the SRMIMI, which found based on his research that advances in computer-based technologies and telecommunications are enabling social networks that facilitate group affiliations, including terrorist networks. The study conflated risks from terror and activist groups, the implications of this fact for criminal, terror, protest and insurgency networks has been explored by Arquilla and Renfelt 2001, and are a common topic of discussion by groups like the Highlands Forum, which perceive that the United States is highly vulnerable to the interruption of critical networks. Arquilla went on to help develop information warfare strategies for the military campaigns in Kosovo, Afghanistan and Iraq. According to military historian Benjamin Shearer in his biographical dictionary, Homefront Heroes 2007 once again illustrating the direct role played by certain key forum members in executing Pentagon information operations in war theaters. In his 2005 New Yorker investigation, the Pulitzer Prize-winning Seymour Hersh referred to a series of articles by Arquilla elaborating on a new strategy of countering terror with pseudo-terror. "It takes a network to fight a network," said Arquilla, drawing on the thesis he had been promoting in the Pentagon through the Highlands Forum since its founding. When conventional military operations and bombing failed to defeat the Momo insurgency in Kenya in the 1950s, the British formed teams of friendly Kikuyu tribesmen, who went about pretending to be terrorists. These pseudo-gangs, as they were called, swiftly threw the Momo on the defensive, either by befriending and then ambushing bands of fighters or by guiding bombers to the terrorists' camps. Arquilla went on to advocate that Western intelligence services should use the British case as a model for creating new pseudo-gang terrorist groups as a way of undermining real terror networks. What worked in Kenya a half century ago has a wonderful chance of undermining trust and recruitment among today's terror networks. Forming new pseudo-gangs should not be difficult. Essentially, Arquilla's argument was that as only networks can fight networks, the only way to defeat enemies conducting irregular warfare is to use techniques of irregular warfare against them. Ultimately, the determining factor in victory is not conventional military defeat per se, but the extent to which the direction of the conflict can be calibrated to influence the population and rally their opposition to the adversary. Arquilla's pseudo-gang strategy was, Hersh reported, already being implemented by the Pentagon. Under Rumsfeld's new approach, I was told, US military operatives would be permitted to pose abroad as corrupt foreign businessmen seeking to buy contraband items that could be used in nuclear weapons systems. In some cases, according to the Pentagon advisors, local citizens could be recruited and asked to join up with guerrillas or terrorists. The new rules will enable the special forces community to set up what it calls action teams in the target countries overseas, which can be used to find and eliminate terrorist organizations. Do you remember the right-wing execution squads in El Salvador? The former high-level intelligence official asked me, referring to the military-led gangs that committed atrocities in the early 1980s. We founded them and we financed them, he said. The objective now is to recruit locals in any area we want. And we aren't going to tell Congress about it. A former military officer, who has knowledge of the Pentagon's commando capabilities, said, We re going to be riding with the bad boys? Official corroboration that the strategy is now operational came with a leak of a 2008 US Army Special Operations Field Manual. The US military, the manual said, can conduct a regular and unconventional warfare by using surrogate non-state groups such as paramilitary forces, individuals, businesses, foreign political organizations, resistant or insurgent organizations, expatriates, transnational terrorism adversaries, disillusioned transnational terrorism members, black marketers, and other social or political undesirables. Shockingly, the manual specifically acknowledged that US special operations can involve both counterterrorism and terrorism, as well as transnational criminal activities, including narco-trafficking, illicit arms dealing, and illegal financial transactions. The purpose of such covert operations is, essentially, population control. They are specifically focused on leveraging some portion of the indigenous population to accept the status quo, or to accept whatever political outcome is being imposed or negotiated. By this twisted logic, terrorism can in some cases be defined as a legitimate tool of a statecraft by which to influence populations into accepting a particular political outcome, all in the name fighting terrorism. Is this what the Pentagon was doing by coordinating the nearly $1 billion of funding from Gulf regimes to anti-Assad rebels, most of which according to the CIA's own classified assessments ended up in the coffers of violent Islamist extremists linked to Al-Qaeda, who went on to spawn the Islamic State? The rationale for the new strategy was first officially set out in an August 2002 briefing for the Pentagon's Defense Science Board, which advocated the creation of a proactive, preemptive operations group, P2OG, within the National Security Council. P2OG, the board proposed, must conduct clandestine operations to infiltrate and stimulate reactions among terrorist networks to provoke them into action, and thus facilitate targeting them. The Defense Science Board is, like other Pentagon agencies, intimately related with the Highlands Forum, whose work feeds into the board's research, which in turn is regularly presented at the forum. According to the US intelligence sources who spoke to Hirsch, Rumsfeld had ensured that the new brand of black operations would be conducted entirely under Pentagon jurisdiction, firewalled off from the CIA and regional US military commanders.